Financial Insider Weekly. I'm your host, Michael Gray, CPA. I'm a little froggy today, got a little bit of a cold, so I apologize in advance, but we're going to charge ahead and do our little interview here today. My guest is Peggy Martin. Peggy is a fee-only financial planner with the Family Wealth Consulting Group. She has more than 33 years of experience in the financial services industry. She started when she was 3 years old. Peggy assists clients with family wealth planning, including legacy, financial, estate, investment, and insurance planning. Her credentials include Masters of Science in Financial Services, Chartered Financial Consultant, Chartered Life Underwriter, Fellow Life Management Institute, and Chartered Advisor for Senior Living. Got lots of credentials there, Peggy.
Yes, indeed.
All that hard work. And today, Peggy and I are talking about socially responsible and sustainable investing. And we've had discussions about this before. I guess you could look at this something of an update and how this field is developing. Craig, thanks for joining me as my guest today.
Mike, it's a pleasure to be here and to be able to talk with you and update about socially responsible and sustainable investing. And as I was getting prepared today for this, I was noticing some correlations in some of the things that I do. I work a lot with clients to do their legacy planning.
Yes.
And to articulate their values and their goals and why their money is important to them, what they want their children to inherit from them, if all of their money or some of their money. What they want their grandchildren to know about them, and do they want their great-grandchildren to know their name? You know who they were, what impact did they make on society, community, family, and so forth. And it struck me that a lot of the folks that I work with enjoy doing the legacy planning work, but they also have a tilt towards socially responsible and sustainable investing. So having had the opportunity to work in philanthropy for many years, also have an idea of how important sustainability is to the local nonprofits, and had the pleasure of being able to work with vision boards in a group that I belong to where we brought pictures of our grandchildren in and said, where do we want them to be 50 years from now? And what kind of community service do we want them to be able to provide? So there was just some commonality in the sustainability component, and thought that's where my passion is. I get a lot of joy out of watching folks be able to articulate what their values are and match it to their investment methodology.
Right. Well, when we talk about socially responsible and sustainable, again, I mean, part of what we're thinking about is, yeah, what kind of world are our children, our grandchildren, our great-grandchildren going to inherit from us? Mm-hmm. And it seems like, you know, in the past, there wasn't a lot of thought about that. It was just sort of charge ahead, mow down the forests. Of course, an awful lot of it, particularly like in the early days of our country, you know, people were just trying to establish a place to live for themselves.
Correct.
But now, I think part of it is, let's just say we've got a shrinking planet. As far as, you know, with humanity and our communication and so forth, and it is our home, and so we need to take care of it. So that sort of dovetails, in a sense, for my first question, and that is why there is a current interest in socially responsible investing and sustainable investing. So maybe you can fill in just a little bit more from your introduction.
Well, if you have a concern about what companies you're investing in, and do you think it's important to protect our environment in the future, it could be that socially responsible, sustainable investing might be a way for you to invest your funds. And another way to look at it is it is personal values investing. Again, getting back to that legacy component.
Yeah.
You know, when you put the name personal values to it versus socially responsible and sustainable, there's lots of definitions for socially responsible and sustainable, but personal values, what's important to you? Have you looked into what kind of companies you are investing in? Do you know what their governance practice is? Do you know if the shareholders care only about the bottom line of the company, or are they also out doing things with community? And are they practicing fair labor law practices. Those types of things can become important with socially responsible and sustainable investing. Socially responsible investing has more of a social conscience to it, where sustainable is more environmental. But they both go hand in hand. In our portfolio designs, we usually use both, the socially responsible and the sustainable. But I like the one definition for sustainable that the mutual fund company we work with has come up with, which is meeting the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. As you alluded to earlier, you know, we've done a lot of things in the past with our environment and cut down trees and polluted waters and a number of different things. And is that what we want for our future generations? Or do we want to start putting practices in place now to assist with that not becoming worse than it is today?
Yeah, okay.
And another great phrase with sustainable and socially responsible, you get to do well by doing good.
There you go. Okay. So how significant has this area become as a growth area in the area of investing?
Well, it's pretty surprising how much money is actually invested in socially responsible and sustainable. Every other year a report comes out. So I'm still working with the 2012 report.
Okay.
But it's put out by the U.S. Social Investment Forum. Mm-hmm. And at the beginning of 2009, there were $3 trillion invested in socially responsible and sustainable. And by the end of 2011, that had grown to $3.74 trillion. Uh-huh. So that's about a 22% increase, so that's pretty significant. Uh-huh. And about $1 out of every $9 is put into socially responsible investing in the United States. So it's growing momentum. Again, I think people, especially the baby boomer generation, is finally realizing things aren't going to last forever. In particular, they're not going to last forever. And what kinds of things do they want to be transferring down to the future generations? And this is an area where some growth is taking place. Another thing to realize with that statistic is also that socially responsible and sustainable takes into consideration, in other words, they're not double counting those assets. Uh-huh. They may fall into both categories, so they're not doing double counting. So that $3 trillion number or $3.74 trillion number is an accurate number as far as assets under management.
Okay. So I'm going to get around those statistics and talk a little bit more about your personal experience.
Okay.
What have you been seeing with your clients and the interest that they've been expressing in this area?
I find typically more women are interested in socially responsible, sustainable investing, that there seems to be that nature-nurture concept, and they ask about it too. So either they've read about it or they're concerned about weapons or, you know, with all the different war conflicts we've had going on. It could be that could be part of it. They also look at their young grandchildren or even maybe children and wonder, you know, what are we doing here? What's it all about? I do get more interest from women, and typically it is women over the age of 55.
Okay.
That are interested.
I think part of it may be, too, that they're thinking, I don't want to subsidize, if you will, within my investment, you know, something that's not healthy. Mm-hmm. So, for example, I don't want to invest in a company that's selling cigarettes to children.
Right.
I don't want to subsidize maybe, like you said, maybe a weapons type company, you know, mm-hmm. defense industry. So, you know, I want to make some choices with, again, what am I supporting, if you will, with my investment choices.
Right. Right.
Yeah. Okay. Well, how many choices are there for mutual funds in this area?
Well, we work with institutional mutual funds, and we work with one company.
Yeah.
And we're able to create a globally diversified portfolio from socially responsible funds. And we have international core funds in both socially responsible and sustainable, U.S. core funds, and emerging markets. And there are lots of companies out there now that have socially responsible and sustainable funds. The advantage, I think, of using institutional funds is that they're lower cost to the consumer, and even lower costs when hiring me as the advisor. And we're able to control risk by the global diversification of the portfolio. And we're also able to work with any kind of tax issues, because we do our best to always work with the tax professional, but also pay attention to what's going on inside of the mutual funds. Are they passing through large capital gains, that type of thing? So we are able to do that as well. But the other thing that's happening too, there seems to be a small trend with some retirement plans now that you can actually pick out socially responsible and sustainable funds to have in your 401k plans. And additionally, there's also ways for investors to work with local banks, credit unions, and other community financial institutions that help to sponsor socially responsible investing as well. So there's a wide range available now that a decade ago probably wasn't there. There's also more financial advisors that are interested in this, you know, that they have become more aware that it's available, and also aware that certain factors are taken into consideration when these funds are put together. A popular phraseology with socially responsible and sustainable is ESG integration. I don't like acronyms, but it's environmental, social, and governance factors. So those kinds of factors go into these mutual funds. The environmental is more sustainable, and of course the social is more social, but governance is for both. The governance is a top-down management of the firm. What are they saying about their practices internally and also with community? So it's an area where there's more available now than there has been in the past.
Yeah, you were mentioning more advisors have become interested. I think part of the reason is because, again, their clients are asking.
Exactly.
And so if the demand is there, then people are going to respond to that.
Right. Well, just simple things like the trigger on the thinking could be the fact that investment companies now, from a green standpoint, are asking you if you want to get your statements online versus having them mailed to you. It's a small contribution to the environmental sustainability, but nevertheless, it is a contribution. Other things that we see happening that give more public awareness to it is just going to your local grocery store now. In Santa Clara County, most of the cities no longer have the plastic bags that groceries get loaded into. You either bring your own bag or you pay 10 cents for the paper bag. So I think there's some things that are happening that give more of a social consciousness to the consuming public.
Okay. What are some individual industries that people have been interested in when they're looking at this area of socially responsible and sustainable investing?
Well, I pondered the answer to this question because our firm does not promote looking for individual industries.
Right.
We promote the global diversification within the portfolio design.
Right. Right.
And whether you be a traditional investor or a socially responsible investor, we promote that diversification. And again, we're fortunate that we're able to work with funds that we pretty much can mirror our traditional portfolio allocation with the socially responsible and sustainable funds. The difference is the socially responsible and sustainable group of funds have screeners to them, whereas the traditional funds do not. And I know we're going to talk about that in a little bit, but they do have the screeners there.
Yeah.
However, I do hear lots of conversations because I'm involved in lots of groups.
Right.
And solar energy is always a conversation that comes up. Gee, should I put that in my house? Should I have that? Will it work? Do I get the right kind of sunlight? A lot of unknown answers there until you have the assessment made. And of course, always the different hybrid vehicles that are available now. You know, a decade ago there were one or two companies doing that. Now many companies offer the hybrids, so that if you want that choice, you're able to find it readily. So it saves some on gas mileage, and gas payments and also helps the environment.
Right. So, and beyond hybrid, I guess to the electric vehicles.
The electric vehicles, yes. Yeah.
So, but I guess what we have to recognize, though, is that these are very high-risk areas when people decide that they want to support them. You know, Tesla is an exciting company. They make a really yeah. neat car. But, you know, if you look at what's hit the bottom line so far, it hasn't been much.
Right.
And it's because, of course, they're trying to get established.
Right.
Unfortunately, there are companies like the one that we bought our electric vehicle from that are no longer with us. So we have to recognize that. On the other hand, there are people that they recognize these risks and they still, again, like I said, they're voting with their investment dollars. They want to try to subsidize and help with development in these areas, with the new technologies and so forth. And so they're willing to take the risks in some cases. You just don't put the whole, you know, nest egg into it.
Yeah, anytime you're working with more of the innovation or entrepreneurship or any of the alternative type investments, you are able to help to create something new for our society and just need to be educated on what personal risk you might be taking in doing that. Mm-hmm. But it's a way companies get started. It's a way new ideas are created. Mm-hmm. And it gives us as a public an opportunity to experience something different.
Right. And if people wouldn't help Edison, we'd be all sitting in the dark.
That's right. There you go.
Okay. So how do the fund managers screen these investments?
Well, each of the areas, socially responsible and sustainable, do have screening mechanisms. The group that we work with, it's a third-party independent that actually does the screening, and the companies are checked periodically to see if they're still matching the universe statement of what is socially responsible and what is sustainable. And as an example, socially responsible, I think in particular, can be somewhat controversial. It's, again, it's all about your values, what's important to you. But examples of the screening are if the company earns at least 20% or more from military weapons or weapons of mass destruction, that company will be out of that particular asset allocation at that point in time. Mm-hmm. The screener will say no. That company can't be a part of this anymore or can't come into this. Uh-huh. If engagement in profit business activities in or with the Republic of Sudan, so again, we're getting into politics and regions and areas where values and cultures are very different. You know, yeah. What's okay for one culture may not work so well for another culture. If you are earning 15% from tobacco and alcohol sales, just like you said earlier, you know, do you want to be promoting a company that is promoting the okay use of cigarettes to the high school students, you know, or making it look so glamorous that that's something that they want to do? Earn 20% of your activities, of your revenues from gambling activities. Those are the kinds of screens. And then there's the medical issues that come up as well. Pharmaceuticals are... companies are screened by these independent third-party organizations on their practices. Stem cell research is another area, again, controversial, you know.
Yeah.
If you pornographic sales. And then the one thing that is really major with a number of the screeners is child labor laws, especially in the international funds and the emerging market funds. What's going on there? What are they doing with the young child labor? How are they handling that? And another one that's kind of interesting, if it's a for health care provider, what are their, if they're a for-profit health care provider, what are their policies? What are their procedures? What are they doing internally with their profits so that the screeners will say yay or nay to them being part of a socially responsible fund. So it encompasses a lot of different screening areas, and I found it pretty interesting when I was reading some updates about that, about how more screening is taking place within some of these funds now.
So one of the things is that if you're thinking of investing in one of these things, or at least, again, I mean, if I was doing it, I'd probably be talking with you about things that I was concerned about. Mm-hmm. If you're choosing one of these funds, let's say off the rack, if you will, maybe looking at a Vanguard socially responsible fund, if there is one that's available, you might want to look at what are the things that they are screening for, and is this something that seems to sort of match with your concerns?
Typically, most of the websites, of course, there's always a prospectus, but those can be kind of cumbersome to read through.
Yeah.
But usually there's some kind of a fact sheet that explains what the fund is doing, what companies the fund is investing in, what the statement of the fund is, also what kind of screening, if it is socially responsible or sustainable, what kind of screening mechanism is being used? Is it a third party? Is it somebody that the mutual fund company is hiring? It's usually less conflict of interest, I think, if it's a third party independent versus somebody that is an employee or of the mutual fund company actually doing the work. For sustainable, their screening is a little different, and they put the screening in a positive tilt versus a negative tilt. Socially responsible, it was negative, kind of, if you're investing 20% or more of your funds in this, we're going to kick you out, basically.
Yeah.
With sustainable, is the company reducing resource consumption? Are they paying attention to emissions, toxins, and pollutants? Do they implement proactive environmental management techniques and systems? And do they help the consumer understand the concept of sustainability?
Uh-huh. Okay. So you were just talking a little bit about when there's a third-party company that's involved in in this evaluation process or screening process. Maybe you could explain that a little bit. How does that work?
Well, what I know about it is kind of an analogy would be kind of similar to what I just went through in a very different area of my life, but I had not been exposed to this before, was having an interview done for long-term care insurance where a third party not hired by the insurance company came out to do an interview on my mother-in-law. Mm-hmm. And definitely it was a third party. The woman had her own business card. She went in and started asking my mother-in-law detailed questions, looked over her home, went through a lot of different areas of cognitive impairment with her, remembering of words, putting together sentences. And from the research that I've seen, there is an analogy there between that and what these third-party companies do. They actually go out and they look at the company. They will go through the financial statements of the company. They will ask for revenue projections from different areas that the company may be involved in so that they know, gee, you are over 20%. You know, you were 25% into military weapons, so you no longer meet our definition.
Mm-hmm.
So it's basically going out and interviewing and understanding the annual reports that the companies put out each year.
Okay. How has designing a portfolio with socially responsible and or sustainable focus affected the return and risk for investors? Mostly, I guess we're talking about your own experience, but maybe you can...
Well, what I have seen thus far with this is that the socially responsible, sustainable funds are, in most time frames, equal to their benchmark or right approaching the benchmark, which means that there isn't a huge compromise currently in the returns. Now, some of the funds are new.
Uh-huh.
So we don't have the track record we do with the traditional funds where we can pretty much tell you for the last 10-year rolling time periods that yes, the funds have or have not beat their benchmark. But from what I'm seeing right now, because of the global diversification within the portfolio and that we have followed the same methodology, we haven't tried to change that. It's just that we're using these funds versus traditional funds.
Right.
And again, the big concept with us is You know, we don't chase returns. We want to control the risk of the portfolio by keeping the diversification there. And then we want to maximize that control of that risk. And we do believe that over your lifetime, if you keep that global diversification in place, you will be very satisfied with being able to maintain your lifestyle.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, we just have like a couple minutes left, so maybe you'd like to share some final thoughts, wisdom and experience that you've picked up in getting involved in this area.
I would say personal values investing is something that is for some people. You need to have a passion around the sustainability of our environment, and you need to have a passion around being socially responsible. No way of investing is good or bad. It's just, what is your passion? What is it that you're trying to create? And if you have a family wealth plan statement, for your family, that you want to have values and goals and your financial objectives be accomplished, which I would encourage whether you're doing traditional or socially responsible. I just think the socially responsible and sustainable causes us to think. Uh-huh. You pause for a moment and think, what is it that I want to create? Now, you may think that, you know, your way of socially responsible might be, gee, I want to invest in companies that do provide the way to protect myself. Mm-hmm. You know, that could be your definition of socially responsible. It's just what works for you as an individual. So I think when families are willing to go through the legacy planning process and really understand what's important to them and why it's important to them, that their investment methodology can be put together that works for them.
Great. Peggy, thanks again for joining me as a guest today. I think that, you know, again, this has been interesting to see. This is a developing area. It's something that that my family is interested in, as you know. We're involved in this ourselves. And I can tell you that my kids, even more so, daughter and so forth, are very concerned about how we're investing and where it's going. Folks, we're all out of time. I hope we've given you some things to think about. We'll see you next time on Financial Insider Weekly.